name. We'll have discussion after we call delivering two papers. Next is Neelam. Good afternoon, everyone. Previous papers have been really interesting, and I think most of the topics that we are discussing and discussing are being repeated, and I think even my paper, like even in my paper, things like alternative sites of knowledge, something that is away from the existing sites of knowledge or what we call legitimate knowledge system, will get repeated even in my paper. I'm with Center of Political Studies, JNU. And the topic I'll be speaking is on a study of ecological knowledge and epistemic justice among Urams. Urams is a tribe mostly inhabited in the states of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Orissa, and even Nepal, Bengal. I think closest Uram you will know here is, I guess it is Sona Charia, means the JNU TA president, just for a reference. So on to my presentation. The last few decades have witnessed the immense growth in the research on indigenous people, their ecological knowledge and sustainable practices. That this debate got particularly popularized because the existing ecological mitigation policies and strategies seemed bereft of any substantial solution to the ecological multiplying and deepening ecological crisis. In this regard, this paper aims at exploring if the Adivasis in India, and Urams in particular, to have enough resources for making significant contributions to the global debate on indigenous people and ecology and in the ecological knowledge system. I'll argue that Urams are epistemic communities, especially with regard to ecological knowledge and sustainable practices around natural resource management, biodiversity conservation, sustainable food and agriculture practices, and climate change resilience. This ecological epistemology is contingent not only on the ecological knowledge per se, but on a cosmology which is a constellation of ecological knowledge, ecological practices, and societal ethics governing the conduct of individual and the society. This indigenous epistemology offers an alternative paradigm to the paradigm of modernity that I claim to have brought about the ecological crisis. However, this paper does not seek to demonstrate the superiority of indigenous ecological knowledge and practices compared with the dominant global scientific knowledge system in particular instances. Neither it goes for an effusive blanket endorsement by presenting an ecological Eden to counter some exemplary world that we have lost. Yet this paradigm claims to offer alternative to systems that have been reasons for the ecological crisis. The reason for the degradation of environment and ecology is the ideology of human supremacy over nature, the reduction of nature and environment into its instrumental value for human beings to be used. Which the ideology that traveled from Aristotle to Cartesian worldview, the inadequacies of Cartesian worldview, to the Spencer doctrine, to the capitalism, Spencerian doctrine of development furnished sociology with his law of survival of the fittest in the marketplace. Capitalism is a process in which certain habits of consumptions are intertwined with the pursuit of profit. Neoliberal capitalism seems to intensify that idea of perpetual happiness and limitless prosperity. The field of ecological modernization and modern resource management is currently dominated by a regime that is utilitarian, reductionist, technocentric, and market-driven. Nation-state as a counterpoint to market-based ecological paradigm could possibly solve the problem at the national level by determining the scale of economic activity at national level and also international level. However, the climate negotiations shows that negotiations among nation states so far show that the world is unable to summon up a worthy response to the deepening ecological crisis. The current situation is an instance of social dilemma where individual and collective rationality are at odds with each other. In this scene, how to achieve the high yet historically unprecedented level of cooperation and policy coordination needed to manage environmental problem at global scale is the question. From here, how do we go towards the alternative paradigm that solves this ecological problem? Within this background of nature, emergence, and continuity of ecological crisis, I evaluate indigenous ecological knowledge, or epistemology, and its relevance for an ecological society. Any indigenous knowledge system, as discussed by Flickert-Burgers, is local, rooted and restricted to a particular place, to a set of experiences. Secondly, it is orally transmitted. This knowledge system is the consequence of practical engagement in everyday life, and it's constantly reinforced by experience, trial and error, and deliberate experiment. It is therefore the product of many generations of intelligent reasoning, and since its failures has immediate consequences for its practitioners, its success is very often a good measure of Darwinian fitness. In other words, it is tested in the rigorous laboratory of survival. This knowledge system tends to be empirical rather than theoretical knowledge in the strict sense. This is therefore constantly changing, being produced as well as reproduced, discovered as well as lost. The indigenous knowledge system is holistic in a way it deals with the environment against the Cartesian reductionistic way of looking at things. It is therefore in consonance with the environmental system that are complex system, showing a number of characteristics not seen in simple system. This I did my field study in three states of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, and Orissa, and I tried to see this theoretical framework in the practices, especially in food and agriculture system, where I found that these villages, I went to the villages, each villages almost possess at least 15 varieties of rice, 15 rice varieties, and different rice varieties are designed to suit the different landscapes, different weather system, and this also requires the alteration of the varieties. For that, villagers themselves circulate their varieties, so for they do not have to charge anything. For the information that the contemporary of Swaminathan, the father of Green Revolution, there was a scientist called Rich Arya. And if you look back, he had 36,000 of rice varieties in Raipur, Agriculture Institute of Raipur, which is lost now, sold to, I think, Syngenta. That is what we lose when we lose this reciprocal relationship that the rice variety actually makes it possible. Second thing, I was trying to see that for sustainability, what is required is how much we can consume the wild varieties. Wild, not in the literal sense, it is a natural, I call it natural rather than wild. In the villages, I found there are almost 15 natural varieties of vegetation, 26 wild plants that people can, natural plants that they can actually consume. And it is not just consumption, because there is a specific time that they have to consume that, and there is a specific way of preparation of that particular plant and variety. I also found that there are 13 types of natural mushrooms that they just can pick and which are edible for them at least. I found the same people in Delhi, those who come to JNU, we have big forests, they pick, though we fear, they pick those mushrooms and they say it's edible and it's tasty. I think this sustainability discourses, this has a wider implications in sustainability discourses, because the more we consume wild varieties, the it is against the agribusiness, it is against industrial farming system, industrial agriculture, it is against the fossil capital, which requires the long transportation of food, which dismantles the local food consumption and production. the similar trends was reflected in the management of natural resources and commons. I'll skip this part and I'll directly go to the cultural norms that have been found among the Adivasis. It is a cosmology where you cannot differentiate between their economy, society, their tradition. So entire thing is interlinked. Interestingly, in the last Indigenous Day celebration that was held in Delhi, a person came up with the idea that Adivasi clock runs anti-clockwise, like the 11 and 1 will exchange their places, so the clock will go. People asked how. They said it is because every natural thing takes a left circle rather than right. Right, every creeper takes left. When they plow, they take left. Right. So even the dance forms, usually they go leftward rather than rightward. I don't know, that was really interesting, yet something I never could notice by myself. I'll go to the concluding part. The realization of an ecological society requires the radical shift from the present economic socio-economic model. It requires breaking away from anthropocentric worldview, fossil capital, industrial food and agriculture practices, capitalism's limitless drive for profits, and modernity's legacy of human supremacy. And this ecological epistemology for Burans offers an instance which respects the complexity of ecosystem and respects its limit and simultaneously breaks the social, economic and other hierarchies, stands counterpoint to the capitalism's profit-driven economy and offers a counterpoint to the tragedy of the commons. There were two epistemological weaknesses that I found in this, which is solved. That if indigenous knowledge is inherently scattered and local in character and gains its vitality from being deeply implicated in people's lives, then the attempt to essentialize, isolate, archive and transfer such knowledge can only seem contradictory. How do we overcome this epistemological weakness or being lack of universality? Each indigenous knowledge is necessarily locally situated. Now, in this model, there may be many indigenous knowledge systems, each of which access the real world in various degrees of imperfection and subjectiveness. From these partial imperfect knowledge can be distilled universal reason by eliminating what is incorrect, subjective, vague, or local through the application of agreed tests of authoritarian validation. Thus, universal reason is a superior understanding of the real world, and that makes indigenous knowledge and science are epistemologically equivalent and equal. Thank you.